He changed the game. The game. The game. The
game. The game. If it wasn't for Michael Vick, all these dual threat quarterbacks would never have gotten an opportunity.
I became a person that I didn't really know. And I was always humble, always respectful. I can honestly say I let money change me. Anytime that happens, that's a recipe for disaster. And it led me down a dark road.
Graphic details about how Michael Vick's Virginia property was the headquarters of Bad News Kennels. The dogs were raised there to fight. That Vick not only financed the operation, but took part in gambling.
I try not to dwell on people's thoughts and their perception because I know I can't change them. I understand it. I don't blame them. I do believe that everybody's entitled to a second chance. I grew up in Newport News, Virginia. Poverty-stricken. Really, Circle was surrounded by a lot of, crime.
911. Three shots. He shot this boy.
Gang-related arrests out of Newport News.
Another drug operation in Newport News apparently concentrated on crack and cocaine.
We had a big drug epidemic. When the drugs hit our community, it just kind of like destroyed it. We kind of lost that sense of community. And things became so bad, it became territory.
I'm from where the hammers rung, news cameras never come. You and your mans hung in every verse in your rhyme. Where the grams were slung, vanish every summer. Where the blue vans would come, we throw the work in the can and run.
It got so scary for other residents in the city. If you white, you didn't come past 25th Street. You was either Jehovah's Witness or you was an insurance man.
Hearing gunshots every night, you really don't understand how detrimental it is to the environment.
We had a large body of water, the Chesapeake Bay, which was maybe 5 minutes away from where I grew up. We used to always just go down to the fishing pier, watch other guys fish. And when I turned 11 years old for my birthday, I got a fishing pole. Going fishing really helped me escape from everything that was taking place in the environment that I grew up in. You know, it was a place of solitude. It was a sanctuary for myself. It was like a safe haven for us in a way that we was able to stay out of trouble.
The older dudes kept us from being in the streets. We had family in the streets, His uncle, pops, everybody, they was in the streets. They were trying to steer him away from the streets.
Playing at the Boys and Girls Club really helped me develop my skill, really helped me develop the talent that I had from the age of 7 years old.
So we became athletes, and he became a damn good one.
He was in seventh grade, and it was recreation, football game I went to see. People have been talking about this little kid, athlete out there. And so watching him, he looked very athletic. And after the game, I went and shook his hand and said, I'm Coach Raymond. The next time that I saw him was in eighth grade. He walked up to me. He said, Coach, I want you to help me get where Aaron Brooks got. Then I saw him lick that wrist. And I've been around the Terry Bradshaws, the NFL quarterbacks of the 60s, 70s, so I knew there was something special.
I think it was just every day, grind throughout all the training camp, our little camps that we had, accuracy, footwork, the basics, the fundamentals, and I really didn't see it until my junior, senior year that I was really starting to progress as a player. I got faster, my arm got stronger, was able to become one of the elite in my district.
He was designed to do certain things at the quarterback position.
It was against Denby High School, and Michael
went around right side. He was supposed to throw in a ball, but he escaped. And he ended up making a cut on a guy. And then he cut right back to the sideline and scored on a touchdown.
I'll never forget after the game, my coach told me that, you know, that was an NFL caliber move. And when you go back and look at it, and I have to show you the highlight tape, you'll see why.
What I saw was remarkable agility. And I said to myself right then, and I said it to him, son, you'll do that again, and it'll be on Sundays.
You know, you hear about different recruits that we recruit. Mike, at that time, I think, was rated number two coming out of the Virginia area. You know, Ronald Curry was the number one player in the country. So I heard more about Ronald Curry than I did Mike.
I was down visiting kids, and there's a kid, Ronald Curry, at the time at Hampton High School, and Michael was at the next school over. Curry was a heck of a player, don't get me wrong. But I knew when I saw Michael, it was something different.
Kevin Rogers, who was my offensive coordinator, he basically told me, look, this will be the next Donovan McNabb and keep the tradition going here at Syracuse. And when you hear something like that, obviously you want to get to meet the kid. Got a chance to talk to him a little bit before he showed up. The kid was hungry. Kid wanted to, he wanted to make a name for himself, make an impression, because he knew being in Virginia, it was about Ronald Curry. We took him around to the campus. We just talked about his goals. One that he wanted to get done, and basically, you know, he told me he wanted to come to Syracuse. And he wanted to come because I was there and wanted to continue on that legacy.
At the time, his mother drove a school bus, and that was parked outside, and it was not in the, you know, the greatest neighborhood. But when you sat there and visited with him and realized what a great mom he had, and I didn't know at the time I was sitting there what the future was, but I knew I liked what was in that living room. I came away from there very hopeful that this guy's going to be at Virginia Tech.
I was excited, coach was excited, but he dropped a bomb on us and said, look, man, you got to talk to my mom. And it's like, well, what's the problem? She wants me to stay home. Which isn't a bad choice, you know, that other school in Virginia, you know, the Blacksburg, Virginia school.
I picked Virginia Tech because, you know, I didn't want to go to Syracuse, and not just didn't want to go to Syracuse, but I didn't want to go try to fill the shoes of another guy. I felt like that was a lot of pressure coming and trying to fill in for Donovan McNabb. He was one of my role models. Just I didn't want to build my legacy behind, you know, somebody else. I wanted to build my own.
Mike Vick was in Virginia Tech around 1998. Me and Pharrell, who is from Virginia Beach, we made this phenomenal record called Super Thug. And for some reason, Newport News kept booking me. And this is a bad hood. Like, this is not, like, I mean, God bless people from Newport News, because Ray has just said that, they probably. But what I'm saying, this is the hood of the hood in Virginia. And Pharrell, he just wasn't a street guy. He didn't know how to get weed. He didn't know how to get, you know what I'm saying? So I would always wind up somewhere around Newport News. Me hearing about Michael Vick in Virginia Tech, and me hearing how, I mean, that whole state was just behind him.
Can anybody get him? He's cutting back against the grain. I think it's lights out.
It was just his movements, it was just his attitude, it was his swagger. It just all identified with us. We had other black quarterbacks, but we didn't have quarterbacks where we were like, he reminds us of us.
Michael Vick does it again, 60 yards on the TD pass.
I'm not sure how many times, like a guy from behind him was about ready to sack him, and all of a sudden he's coming out of there and running for a first. Thought at the time, but how did he know that guy was back there?
Look at Michael Vick, it's a foot race.
Michael Vick became a common name that most people would know. But I think Virginia Tech became a name in the college football world.
Hey, yo, we light a candle, run laps around the English Channel. Neptune's, I got a cocker spaniel. We on the run now, you know it ain't no fun now.
It was like what we see now with Steph Curry's jump shot. It's just a flick of the wrist. I remember him throwing a post pattern about 55 yards, and it looked like it was on a rope. It was nonchalant, it was flawless, it was no effort at all. Tight spiral, right on the money. And I'm just looking like, wow, that's amazing. I've never seen anything like that.
Oh my, the ball was launched.
When Michael Vick went to Virginia Tech, the notion of the black quarterback was still a rare entity. I mean, Michael Vick was frequently called the greatest athlete to ever play the position at that time, and he might have been.
We talked about Michael Vick being Superman. Guess what? He can leap over tall buildings with a single bound.
I was pissed off, but my excitement was, wow, look, this is the guy that should have been in the orange and blue. But I was excited because here's a guy that I got a chance to get to know. Seeing the progression of where he's at and the playing that national championship game against Florida State, I mean, he came onto the scene like no other. Like, I've never seen that from a young quarterback.
I was a rookie at Green Bay, and he hits the spotlight, and all of a sudden, they playing a national championship against Florida State. I couldn't believe it. I was like, get the f*** out of here. This is unbelievable. He's about to beat the team by himself.
Have you ever seen anything like this?
And he did things athletically that you just weren't accustomed to seeing at the quarterback position. And so that made people stop. The combination of what he looked like and black skin and that kind of talent just made people stop and pay attention.
I was pissed. Again, he went to that school in Blacksburg and they're in the Big East. When he came up to Syracuse, I think we had a conversation that week of just, you should be on the other side. But I just couldn't get over why it had to happen to us. You know, he sealed the deal with using his legs. And I don't care what nobody say, he was one of the fastest I've seen at that position.
In a stunned house here at the Carrier Dome.
Well, I just broke for a 55-yard run off a fake bootleg right. Made the fake, came around the end, and beat the whole defense with speed. And one of my best plays.
That run just solidified to the public how great an athlete you are. This kid is a once-in-a-lifetime talent.
At that age, you don't know what revolutionizing the position means. So changing the game was one thing. I was just playing. You know, I didn't know what I was doing.
When Mike first got drafted, I actually went to the draft that year. He was scheduled to go to New Orleans to work out with a trainer. I had got traded to New Orleans Saints, and it was a perfect opportunity for him and I to bond. And I was like, look, man, this is what we're going to do. We're going to talk about life skills. Start thinking long term, you know, start thinking about things that matter. So it was kind of a hard shell to crack because, you know, I'm trying to say one thing to him and he's thinking another. And so, although he heard me, but I don't think he heard me.
The stardom that I got, you know, when I was young, I didn't prepare for it. You know, everything happened so fast, I just dealt with it. The way I grew up, you know, I was taught not to trust a lot of people, so it takes a lot to gain my trust. You know, I just started to see life in a different form. And, you know, it was fun, it was vibrant. You know, I had a great time, you know, throughout all those years and, you know, especially when I got to Atlanta. Right off the top, going down to Green Bay, winning that first playoff game at the age of 22. And not too many people believing in us. From what happened my rookie year to my second year, the development and the growth was uncanny.
Sacrifice. I seen a kid that was trying to learn an offense and get embedded in that offense, but still understanding his talents, still understanding how he could take over a game. And that's rare. You don't see a lot of guys coming into the game thinking, I'm gonna win this game.
To be a starter at a young age, you really don't, you know, understand the magnitude of it. It was a remarkable time. It was a great opportunity. And also the NFC Championship game in 2004, which was a major accomplishment.
EA Sports, it's in the game.
EA Sports, it's in the game.
Being on the Madden cover was surreal. Me being able to score on the video game at any time from anywhere makes me wish I could do it in real life.
He was the Bo Jackson. You talking about at that time, PlayStation was so hot. It took me back to Tecmo Bowl. You know, when you think of Tecmo Bowl and all the great players that have played, everybody mentions one player that you could not stop, and that's Bo Jackson. Everybody wanted to be Atlanta, you know, because of Vic.
It was almost like a cheat code. So, you know, big up to the guys at Madden, man. They did a great job with that, and it was real. It wasn't something that they had made up. It was something that they seen me do on the football field. It just translated over to the video game.
Man, welcome back home. I mean, we'll always love. You know what I'm saying? We got NBA, baby.
He was the one that I knew that everybody from hip hop was just like, you know, it's a Vic game on. Let's go and watch it. Let's go get our popcorn. Let's get bent. It was dope, man. It was a dope experience for me to see a person that I felt like represented us.
He could turn something into nothing. That's why we embrace him so much, because we did the exact same thing.
Atlanta was the bed of hip hop, beautiful women. It was just the place you go to enjoy. And Mike was the face of Atlanta. And to be honest with you, still is probably the face of Atlanta.
It see me in the street, but shout it, you don't know. When you holler, when you speak, remember, you don't know. Save all the hating and the popping, pimping, you don't know. Quit telling people you my partner, listen, you don't know.
It was almost at a time you couldn't shoot a video, and if Michael Vick didn't have a cameo in your video, it wasn't too cool of a video.
Vick did what he wanted to do, and that's what hip-hop is. It's a form of showing off. We know that we all sat there and watched this game on Sunday, and we seen Vick bust some ass. And we're gonna say we're gonna bust your ass like Michael Vick. It's just, it's a hip-hop lyric.
Atlanta, the success of the team. They had us paying attention, so why y'all paying attention to the team and Michael Vick? We gonna sneak our music up in here too.
Michael Jordan was the greatest of all time, but he wasn't hip-hop. But Mike Vick was every young kid's dream, playing in the slums. He was that relatable. He made you feel like you could play football. Everything Mike did became a metaphor, whether it was I'm quick like Mike Vick, you know what I'm saying? Everything that Mike did became a substance for somebody, an artist to rap about.
He didn't change who he was, so the hip-hop community kind of like gravitated to that. And then he wanted to stay true to his voice. He wanted to keep the street credibility.
I make the similarity to Allen Iverson with Michael Vick. There was a point where we all, as a community or whatever, we all wanted to be like Allen Iverson. So we wore our hair like Allen Iverson. So there's a point where we all wanted to be like Michael Vick.
Vic comes from an area, the whole Hampton Roads, Virginia Beach. That area is one in which there's a lot of pride in athletes. Allen Iverson, just to pick another guy, iconic figure, is from that area. There's a certain defiance.
Mike didn't like talking to the media.
Man, I don't want to hear that question again. If I can throw the ball from the pocket, if I can make plays from the pocket, because I feel like I answered him, so I don't ever want to hear that again.
You have a job. Your job is to talk to the media.
They were not of the mainstream or not perceived to be of it. And so that alone gave Vic a certain anti-establishment counterculture identity.
Young man that has been exposed to the most phenomenal rise to stardom, and now you're saying, do you know how to handle it? Privately, within people around him, I saw a kid that was reaching out in the wrong way of having the right support cast. And he was not mentored that way. He was not.
Talking to a lot of his teammates at that particular time, and I would always complain to Mike about, hey man, why are you going home so much? And it's like, I understand that, but every week, and it was going home. It was going home. He kept going back home. I mean, you got your boys sitting in the house just kind of living it up.
They say a fool today is a fool tomorrow with money. You're not protecting yourself for what's to come along the ride. He allowed that to take him to those dark places, places he didn't really wanted to be.
At 24 years old, it was just Mike's world. I wanted to do it my way and my way only. At some point, the splash of arrogance, I think, overtook me. It's just a situation where you kind of lose sight of what's right, like the head down the dead end road. always had a passion for animals, and I always had a dog. I kept a dog wherever I can keep it. My mom wouldn't let me keep one in the house, so I always snuck and had a dog hidden somewhere. Took care of it.
As a resident, you couldn't have dogs in your apartment. The housing authority wouldn't allow that. But there was plenty of stray dogs floating around here in our projects, to where it was nothing for them. We used to come, you know, to get a dog and another dog and fight them. So that was the norm around here.
The day I seen that dog fight, something changed. I didn't know dogs would react in the way that they did. Bad News Kennels started in 2001. It was kind of technical, training a boxer.
Virginia Beach Drug Task Force had a drug sniffing dog. There was a club which a lot of drug dealers were at. The dog hit on this one car. When the gentleman came out to the car, they interviewed him, they arrested him, and basically he said that he was living on the Moonlight Road residence.
Devon Bodie, on April 20th, was arrested on drug charges outside this Hampton nightclub.
Based on that information, the state police and local sheriff's office conducted a search warrant.
Why does this NFL player have a property in this area of the country? It's really rural. What's he doing here? I went to a local real estate agent and asked, why would an NFL player have a property like this here in rural Virginia? A local real estate person said, if you're doing something you don't want people to know about. I immediately called my boss and said, there's something here.
I received a call from a deputy sheriff, Bill Brinkman, and asked for my assistance. And he talked to the informant, had a lot of information which he gave me. He talked about the dogfighting activities on Vic's residence. He talked about how the dogs were executed, the dogs that did not fight. They called it rolling, where they tested the dogs for how vicious they were. And if they didn't fight, then they would kill them. They were hung, they were drowned, and they were slammed to death.
I found a person who had claimed to have fought a dog against Vic. I went to law enforcement and I asked them to vouch for this person's credibility if they were in fact a known dog fighter. It turns out that this person was an informant for law enforcement for dog fighting. He would go undercover, and in exchange for him getting out of prison once for dog fighting and not going back to prison, he was allowed to attend dog fights as an informant for the government. He had been to a number of fights. At one particular fight, he fought a dog against Vic.
We then had a group of state police and special agents from the USDA execute the search warrant. You had a two-story house where the actual fights occurred, and it occurred in the upstairs. It was a pull-down staircase. When you go up into the actual dogfighting house, you would see some blood stains on the floor. You'd see scratch marks. When we dug at the areas that the informant told us, and we uncovered the dogs, I remember one of the first ones when you would see the face of a dog looking at you, and its eyes were wide open and almost looked like it was just, you know, staring right at you.
I was on the golf course, and I just immediately thought that everything was going to come crashing down. I knew that the investigation was going to be deeper, and that somebody was going to try to figure out what was going on.
Roger Goodell, a commissioner, did meet with Vic in April and asked him straight out, when these allegations first surfaced, did you have anything to do with this? And reportedly, Vic denied it.
Police investigating allegations of drugs found evidence of dog fighting in a Virginia home owned by Michael Vick. The Atlanta Falcon quarterback says he did have a kennel operation, but denied any involvement or knowledge of a dog fighting ring at his house.
Number one smoking gun was when we interviewed Tony Taylor. Tony Taylor was basically kicked out of the Bad News Kennel Group. He was part of the dog fighting operation, was a friend of Juanis Phillips, Cornell Pease, and Michael Vick. He was one who had the idea of building a house and a dogfighting operation in Surry County.
According to the charges, it all began in the summer of 2001 at Vic's home in Surrey, purposely designed as a stage for dogfighting.
He was kicked out. He found all the stuff outside the gate. One night he came back, and he was no longer part of the Bad News Kennel operation. We approached Tony Taylor. He agreed to cooperate with us on the dogfighting case. And he brought a picture of all four of them at a dogfight in, I believe it was North Carolina.
Two of Vic's co-defendants were there to plead guilty to operating an illegal dogfighting ring out of Vic's home in Virginia. The men tied the Atlanta Falcons player to some of the most brutal allegations, including killing dogs that lost fights, something that has animal rights groups outraged.
From star athlete to convicted felon, his lawyer says Michael Vick will plead guilty next Monday to federal conspiracy charges.
When the case came to a guilty verdict, there was a statement of facts of what occurred, and Mr. Vick signed that that's actually what happened, and that was part of the statement of facts. That means that he took part in killing the 6 to 8 dogs by hanging, drowning, and slamming to death.
To your knowledge with the investigation, what other NFL or professional athletes were known to be frequent members at these dogfights?
I can't comment on that.
It was literally like a Hollywood movie set. There were blocks of protesters lining the streets. Everyone was vying for the shot of Vic going into the courthouse. Getting a seat in the courtroom was so hard to do that we actually hired local college kids to start to stand in line for us at 4 in the morning, because we knew we'd be reporting on the story till 11 at night.
I'm a son of the South. I'm not of the South, I'm over the Midwest. But as a son of the South, I know that I've heard about dogfighting long before Michael Vick. And people could be naive about it, this that they want. What Michael Vick did was wrong, criminally wrong. But he operated in a culture in which that was not all that rare. I remember talking to friends from the South, the Deep South, the Mid-South, during this time, and I'd say, what do you know about dogfighting? I've been around dogfighting, seen it since I was a kid.
Dogs want to please their master. Now you're putting this dog in this position where it's going to be physically harmed, routinely, and psychologically scarred, all because it's trying to please you. You're taking advantage of that and abusing it. Like a kid, right? Like a child. I think that people equate what he did with child abuse.
I thought it was unfair, unjustified. I thought he was being made an example. We come from a culture, we see dogs as dogs. They're dogs. We don't treat them like humans. We don't put sweaters on them. You know what I mean? We might throw a collar or chain on them. But we see them as dogs. That's what they are.
It's unfair to our culture. You know what I mean? Because now you saying that your culture, you better than us because you don't fight dogs or you haven't done anything bad with the dog or whatever, whatever.
Animal rights protesters target their rage at an NFL star as he enters a federal courthouse.
You don't say anything about people who shoot deers and shoot other animals. It's tough that, you know, we build Michael Vick up and then we break him down.
How profoundly disappointed and saddened we are by the actions that Michael has admitted to. He has let down his fans and his team, he's damaged the reputation of our club and the entire National Football League.
Vic stood without emotion as the federal judge handed down a 23-month prison sentence, followed by 3 years probation for his role in a dogfighting operation.
It's just one of those seminal moments that seemed to stop in time. People were just hungry to hear something from him. They wanted to get a sense of whether or not he was contrite, probably one of the more anticipated press conferences in sports history.
I take full responsibility for my actions. Not for 1 second will I sit right here and point the finger and try to blame anybody else for my actions or what I've done. I'm totally responsible. I totally ask for forgiveness and understanding as I move forward to bettering Michael Vick, the person, I will redeem myself. I have to. The lowest moment was when I had to tell my son that I was going to prison and that I was going to be gone for 2 years. He just broke down crying, and the only thing I could tell him was that daddy was leaving. The toughest moment of my life. You reflect on everything that you had, everything that you won't have, and what you're leaving. Wake yourself up and tell yourself that it's real. I cried all the way to the prison. I mean, all the way up until I got out the car and you know, walked up to the guards and put my hands in handcuffs. And even then, you know, I still, you know, felt like at some point this was just a dream and I was going to not wake up, but somebody was going to come and, you know, relieve me. First day was tough. Second day was tough. The third, fourth, and fifth day when it started to settle in that you're not going home and you're talking to your family and they're feeling the same way that you feel. It's no form of jubilation. It's all sadness, you know, from my sinister acts. There's no explanation for it. No way of consoling anybody. There's no way of consoling myself.
Being away from the game when I was in Kansas and, you know, the other places that I went, you know, during my incarceration, really gave me a chance to reflect on what I was missing. And not from a football perspective, but what I was missing in my life. And there were so many things that had to be tightened up and, you know, had to be, you know, consolidated in my life and in terms of, you know, family and friends and finances. And I really didn't have a stronghold on it, but I wanted it.
He would talk about wanting to get out and would he get another chance? When your rights are taken away from you, you're gonna grow.
That opportunity away from the game of football, away from my family, really gave me a chance to reflect and visualize, you know, what the next chapter in my life had to be about and what it had to be predicated to. And, you know, I was committed to making change on the football field and off the field. First learned how to play the game of chess, you know, I was incarcerated. And, you know, I had a lot of idle time and I wanted to do something to kill time. And when I first started to play the game and I finally got a grasp of it and what the game was actually about, and I found that it was a mental challenge between yourself and your opposition, the opponents you're playing, I deeply fell in love with it because it was another way to compete. Just to have that competition in a different way, you know, during my circumstances, it made me gravitate to the game, and, you know, now I love it more than I love playing my PlayStation. The game of chess, in one definition to me, is like the game of life. Every piece represents itself, it has its own actual movement, and I think, you know, life, you know, transpires in that way. You know, everything happens in phases. Everything almost has to be well planned out and thought out. I always compare football to chess. And when you're dealing with an opponent, whoever executes on that one play, which is like one move per side in chess, has a direct correlation. And if you make the least amount of mistakes, you win. I think chess made me a better quarterback because I don't take calculated risks. You have to be able to see things happen before they happen. In that case, it's called a pre-snap read. You have to be able to see the defense disguise and end up in the defense that you know they're gonna play. That's a correlation to chess and taking care of my pieces and just trying to have as many as I can and trying to make sure that I can destroy my opponent. I became one of the maybe top 20 players in Kansas. It was a lot of guys who could play, who was, you know, very smart, you know, guys from all different backgrounds. Just me being able to work my way up from a guy who didn't know how to play in 18 months, beating some of the guys who beat me and taught me how to do certain moves and taught me how to play, taught me strategy. It was a different type of accomplishment. And, you know, that was something that I could walk away with saying that, hey, I took some away from it that's gonna apply to my day-to-day life. And, you know, I was extremely proud of it.
I was elated, you know, to get back home to my family, you know, more than anything. But to be home, to have the opportunity to make change, seeing my kids, seeing my fiance at the time, really gave me an opportunity to start to dream and believe again.
Now out of federal prison in Kansas, Michael Vick is coming here to his home in Hampton, Virginia, where he'll try to pick up the pieces and rebuild his life.
There's really no way to stay in shape while I was incarcerated. You know, the most that you can do is, you know, push-ups, sit-ups, and dips. I walk the track every day, maybe sometimes five times a day.
I remember one Saturday, I think it was a Saturday, my financial guy called. And he's like, hey, I want you to talk to somebody. And I was like, talk to who? And he's like, yeah, you're like this man. You know, you talk to him enough. He needs your help. And I'm like, all right, well, who is he? And I heard him in the background. And I'm like, Seven, we start talking. What's your goals? What do you want to do? And he's like, I got to get back in. I said, you want to get back in, or do you want to get back in and take over? And he told me, he said, Five, I want to take the game back over. I said, well, how about this? And I shot a bullet in the air, you know. I said, what if I talk to Andy about bringing you back in, getting back on your feet, learning the game of how to be a professional, and then see what happens? He stopped, and he's like, you would do that? I said, why not? I'd take care of my brother. And he's like, I would love that. I talked to Andy, and Andy had that same reaction. Andy said, are you serious? And I was like, yeah. I said, hey, it's like my little brother. I said, I think it will be good for him, but I think it would also be good for our team.
I want to send a special thanks to Donovan McNabb. He's a great friend, and for reaching out to Andy and just, you know, giving Andy the time to think about, you know, the decision that he made and bringing me in. Donovan played a part in bringing me in. I think Andy, you know, really felt like at some point I could help the football team. He gave me some time to get myself in tip-top shape.
I've talked to Bill Polian. I've talked to so many other guys who are like, look, nobody in this league, I guarantee, would do that what you did. Enough to open up to get him here at the same position you play. And I'm like, I don't look at it as a threat. I look at it as a bonus for him and for us.
Marty Morningwig and I, you know, after every practice, stayed out an extra 45 minutes, and I would run, and he would take me through you know, cone drills and drop backs, and I just remember being exhausted, and, you know, Donovan would sit out there and watch it.
I remember we were working out, and I'm like, man, you got a bird chest. Like, man, and like, you struggling over here. You all right? He's like, man, I ain't ever gonna work out like this. And I'm like, believe me, it'll pay off.
At the end of the day, I was drained, but at the same time, you know, Coach Reed told me that, you know, the hard work would pay off at some point. And I didn't know that in 2010 I would get the opportunity and a chance to play for the Philadelphia Eagles, you know, as a full-time starter. To come back and ultimately win Comeback Player of the Year and really get back to the apex of my game really showed that at the age of 30 that I still had the God-given gifts to play good football, to be consistent, and to lead a team to the playoffs.
I had got traded to the Redskins. We played a Monday night. The funny thing was, going into that game, I talked to a couple of players, and they told me what the first play was going to be. I talked to Jim Hazard, our defensive coordinator. They're going deep to Deshaun. So whatever you got to do, make sure we play deep, because they're going to go deep to Deshaun. Ball goes up, I'm looking at Deshaun, and I looked at the offense and said, are you kidding me? Touchdown. I'm like, how stupid can we be after I just told you what the play was going to be? And he lit it up, torched us. I mean, it was embarrassing.
Michael Vick, amazing. 4.25 speed, faster than anybody on the field. Forget about it.
To me, what he did and was the best ever that I saw had been around, it's just kind of throughout the NFL right now.
That element of athleticism, that element of running and throwing and making people miss when defensive players are bigger and faster and stronger than ever, you have to have a Michael Vick component. So now, you know, you see more athletic quarterbacks. In the evolution of the position of quarterback and how to play the game, Vick has to have a chapter in that book.
Historical context I have on the NFL is that, you know, I won't say, you know, I made it cool for, you know, quarterbacks to be able to run because they was running before me. You know, I did it on such a different level. I think, you know, there were a lot of general managers who, you know, kind of said, I want to try that type of guy. You know, I want to try that type of quarterback. And, you know, it's transcended over the years. You know, you've seen a lot of guys who don't play like me. They play like themselves, but it's just, you know, my style of play. I didn't invent the way I play football. I just did it a little faster than most. And the game will continue to evolve. It'll continue to get better. And, you know, you'll see more guys doing it at a high level in the future.
I appreciate the moment to talk about the very important bill, House Bill 1516, which allows police officers to rescue pets and left in hot cars. I know that I'm an unlikely advocate. I was part of the problem when I was at my lowest. I made a decision to make change, and I stand by that. Now that I can reach people that activists can't reach, I appreciate that.
I think the off-the-field advocacy is something that is personal. You target something specifically that, you know, and that inspires you and that you want to see dramatic change in. And, you know, I told myself that I wanted to be an instrument of change, an agent of change, you know, post-incarceration.
I'm glad to be here on Capitol Hill, my first ever lobbying trip to support the Animal Fighting Spectator Prohibition Act. I deeply regret my previous involvement in dog fighting. I'm sorry for what I did to the animals. During my time in prison, I told myself that I wanted to be a part of the solution and not the problem.
It was gratifying for me and no one else. And I do it for myself and my family and for anybody else's gratification.
We'll fly home every week, to go home and fight dogs. For what reason? I don't know, to this day. You know, something so pointless.
As a culture, we tend to like to give people second chances if we think they earn it. And he earned it. He earned it on the field, he earned it off the field. You heard Michael Vick talk. He was no longer the defiant, you know, middle finger young man that he had been. There was some introspection to him. There was a sense of, okay, this was wrong. And here's what I plan to do to try and make amends if you'll let me.
Over years, we all mature and understand a little bit more about life. He learned, obviously, with the mistake that he made. And sometimes when you make mistakes, it shines light on something that you should have been a part of.
I was naive to it, but it's no excuse. I should have known better, and so it's a saying, when you know better, you do better. Use me as an example.
He deserves a second chance. Of course he does. Of course he does. Here's the thing. What he did, obviously, was terrible. But he served his time. He served the time that he deserved. When somebody pays their debt to society, as long as they don't make the same mistake again, you have to move on. And no one knows whether or not he's sincere. He's done and said all the right things, it seems. So why would you not give the person a chance to move forward?
I've learned that animal welfare bills nationwide do not get enough attention, and I'm hoping that this bill gets enough attention. There's no opposition to this bill. I think we just have to care. Please consider House Bill 1516. Together we can be instruments of change. Thank you.
I think the best part of it for me is, you know, just having the chance to see change, and I think it'll prevent us from doing certain things and going down a certain path. So I think, you know, just the opportunity to, you know, continue to ingrain it in the kids' mind that, look, this is what you don't do, this is what you can do, this is what you're not to do, you know, it's pretty prolific.
The world turned on him, but I think it's a great credit to him that he didn't just bail, that he didn't go hole up somewhere and hide, and he confronted this head on. If people are gonna talk about folks reclaiming themselves and rehabilitating themselves, what better example is there than Michael Vick in terms of our recent world in sports?
I wish I could take back some of the things that I did, but the solution is, for me, is to help more animals than I harmed in the past. And if I can get 50 to 100 kids or 1,000 people to do, to help out with this cause and help animals, then I'm doing my job.
Tells me that there's great remorse, there's great guilt. Is he an angel? I don't think so. But I think the changes that he seems to have made looking from the outside in are substantive changes. And I think he should be applauded for that.
You know, it's a lot of sinister acts going on in this world. And this was a situation that needed attention. That may be the reason that, you know, I went through what I went through to help other people to not go through the situation I went through.
If we're educated and we know, then I think it'll prevent us from doing certain things and going down a certain path. Get all of this, man. It's uncensored. Get everything. These things can be done. Seatbelt going off. It's always a pleasure to come back to school, see a lot of old faces. I'm excited about that. Always excited to see Frank. You know, he always stressed that, you know, characters is best perceived by what you do when people not watching. I'm seeing examples of that over our lifetime. What you do when people not watching. It's not what you do when they watch. It's easy to put on the front. But when the cameras stop rolling, I'm gonna see a different man.